Red lights flash. The crew scatters across the hull of the space cruiser in a blind panic. All of their models, all of their projections. How could they have been so wrong? The captain stares down at the data being fed to him through the ship's state-of-the-art navigational computer, while the astronomers pore through their research for answers. No, no, this can't be. Buzz Lightyear may have gone to infinity and beyond, but this is beyond the beyond. They're about to enter the impossible galaxy, the galaxy that isn't meant to exist. The human race managed to go from the Wright brothers first taking flight to Neil Armstrong stepping out onto the moon in just 66 years. Throughout all of human history, flight had eluded us century after century, and then suddenly within one lifetime, it not only became possible, but the technology accelerated so quickly that we were setting foot on another celestial body. It's no wonder that science fiction writers in the 1960s were dreaming of mankind colonizing space by the 21st century. Yet, here we are today, now having to rely on Elon Musk to land people on Mars. With technology advancing as quickly as ever, we're looking at you, our AI overlords. Why is it that we're no closer to a life among the stars? Surely we must know all there is to know about space by now. Are there any mysteries still out there lurking beyond the reaches of our understanding? What will we find when we finally take off from this planet for good? How about we try it? Together, let's fast forward 10,000 years into the future and take a trip out into the unknown reaches of space. What mysteries will we find that science tells us just shouldn't be possible? Let's discover an impossible galaxy. Firstly, let's begin with our ship. Way back in the 21st century, they used to say that interstellar travel was impossible, at least within your own lifetime. The speed of light, 299,792,458 meters a second, is the theoretical speed limit of the universe. Nothing can go faster than that. If you were to accelerate up to 99.99% of that speed limit, it would take you 4.24 years just to get to our next-door neighbor star, Alpha Centauri. Considering there are between 100 and 400 billion stars in our galaxy, the Milky Way, and we're nestled somewhere in the Milky Way's inner city, it would take a ridiculously long time to get out this way. Earth is roughly 20,000 to 30,000 light-years from the center of the Milky Way galaxy, but we know its radius is around 1 million light-years. How can we travel to another galaxy when it takes us 970,000 years just to reach the edge of our own? To do any kind of intergalactic travel, humanity needed a cheat code, and we found one, but not in the place we were looking for. As we used up the last of our planet's natural resources, our sun started to burn colder, and entropy steadily released our world's energy as useless heat, and we faced a real energy crisis. The human race was on the verge of extinction as our brightest scientists looked for a way to construct something to provide us with unlimited energy to keep up with our ever-growing population. In came what's called a Dyson sphere. Once reserved only for the realm of science fiction, our advanced technology and global desperation finally caught up to the idea. The way it works is you find a celestial body like a star with enormous amounts of gravitational pull. Gravity, mass, and energy are all intertwined on a cosmic level. Where you find a source of one, you'll find others. At first, our sights were small. We constructed a simple shell around our sun, lined with solar panels. This gave us a large amount of energy, sure enough, but we were capable of so much more. So we upgraded from a star to something much more exciting, a black hole. By creating a stable man-made black hole ourselves, don't worry about how we achieved that, we were able to construct a new kind of Dyson sphere. With this one, there were no solar panels. Instead, we left a small spot open on one part of it, through which we would launch tiny amounts of matter. That matter would whiz around inside, accelerating around the black hole to near the speed of light, building up large amounts of energy. These particles would fly away from the black hole so fast, they'd ping into the walls of the sphere. With each of these impacts, we could generate enormous amounts of energy, almost free of charge, and we now had a source of near-limitless energy. The world became a utopia. World hunger was eliminated right away. Of course, we'd lost our sun, so we had to construct an artificial sky made from TV screens all around the Earth to give us light and extensive underfloor heating to keep us warm. But ignore those horribly dystopian ideas, it was great. And in the midst of all this, we discovered something remarkable, the key to interstellar travel. An idea long theorized since the publication of Einstein's theory of general relativity resurfaced, and it was quickly proven to be true. Wormholes. Trying to stabilize a wormhole so that it doesn't just immediately collapse in on itself was very tricky. Trying to stretch one enough to send a human through was even harder. Then, constructing a ship tough enough to enter the black hole and come out the other side, even though this would be practically impossible. We're in the future. It works. Don't ask too many questions. The point is, we've worked out a way to travel through wormholes and explore other galaxies. The only question that matters now is, are you in? Good. Then let's go and discover an impossible galaxy. Strap in. We're going to open the hatch on this Dyson sphere and plummet through the heart of a wormhole. You might feel your spine crack a couple of times as the gravity stretches you out thinner than a piece of spaghetti. Hold on tight, and we made it. Welcome to the edge of the Milky Way, where we're taking our first stop. If you look out the window, you can see the entire galaxy stretching out before you. You think you jumped a long way into the future, traveling forward 10,000 years? In the grand scale of this galaxy, that would amount to just 0.00007% of the time that it's existed, 13.6 billion years old. It's actually its birthday today, so we brought cake. Here's a slice for you. If the Milky Way is that old, then how old must the universe itself be? Surely it must be trillions of years. Surprisingly, it isn't. The Milky Way is 13.6 billion years old. The universe itself is 13.8. Just a cool 200 million years between them. Our galaxy is almost the same age as the universe itself. Remember this, because it's going to become really important later when we start to visit some of our other galaxies. But for now, let's just keep on taking in this view. I can see my house from here. So can you. In fact, you can see everywhere you've ever been. It's all right there. That tiny dot, it's our sun. It's one in 400 billion stars all slowly swirling around the galactic center, a supermassive black hole. This thing dwarfs that little Dyson sphere black hole. You've probably heard of it. It's called Sagittarius A, and it's around 4 million times the mass of our sun. Around it swirl a cluster of stars, all steadily getting closer and closer to falling in. The gravity from this galactic center is so strong, it's able to pull entire stars into its orbit from a million light years away. We like to imagine our own sun as staying still and the Earth orbiting around it. But the reality is that our sun is even punier in comparison to this galactic center than our planet is to it. Our sun is 330,000 times as massive as the Earth. Sagittarius A is 4 million times as massive as the Sun. We are tiny, so tiny that even though our Sun is relatively close to the galactic center, it still takes 250 million years for our Sun to complete one orbit around the Milky Way. In between all those stars isn't just empty space either. There are planets, asteroids, and most importantly for where we're going next, nebulae. Enough sightseeing, we've got plenty more traveling to do. Hope you finished your cake because it's time for us to plummet into another wormhole. Hold on to something. Or don't. It's going to be excruciatingly uncomfortable to be stretched out by gravity, whether you're holding on to something or not. Here we go. Now that wasn't so bad, was it? Welcome to our first impossible galaxy. So as to not blow your tiny little caveman 21st century brains too much, we're only going to take you to galaxies that your primitive people have already discovered, thanks largely to your latest cutting-edge telescope, the James Webb Space Telescope. How quaint. Launched Christmas Day 2021, the JWST marked a big step forward from the Hubble telescope. Hubble operated by magnifying visible light to help astronomers see in greater detail what the night sky looked like. It was launched into orbit in 1990, an essential step as you can only see so much from ground level. After all, telescopes on Earth's surface have several miles of atmosphere between them and space. To us, in day-to-day life, air seems pretty invisible. But when you're trying to look in detail at the tiniest star in the night sky, you suddenly realize just how much it gets in the way. Photons hit the tiniest scattered gas particles and bounce around in all different directions. Even in the darkest, most remote, or high-up corners of the world, where we established observatories, the simple fact was that there was no getting around our atmosphere. Hubble wasn't the first space telescope. But it was by far the most famous in human history, as it presented such a tremendous leap forward in our ability to image the stars. It contains in it a 2.4-meter mirror with five main instruments. These instruments are capable of observing visible light, which is defined as all of the light the human eye can see, as well as ultraviolet light, which goes off in the upper end of our visible spectrum with its shorter wavelength, and near-infrared, which goes below. The most famous photo to come from the Hubble telescope was called the Pillars of Creation. It shows, in rich color, three pillars of gas and dust in the Eagle Nebula, around 7,000 light-years from Earth. The reason it's called the Pillars of Creation is because inside those nebulae, new stars are being formed. Plumes of gas and dust thousands of miles in each direction slowly converge under their own gravity, getting hotter and hotter until they reach critical mass and ignite into a star. It's believed that every star in the universe was born from a gas cloud just like these. It's both a look into our past and another solar system's future. And it's precisely because of gas clouds that this galaxy we are in should not exist. Take a look around. Do you see what's missing? Exactly. No gas clouds. But we'll get to that in a moment, because gas clouds are the reason why the James Webb Space Telescope was such an upgrade over the Hubble. The older telescope was operating mostly in the visible light spectrum, or just outside of it. It's fairly similar to how we see things, though with its colors modified and everything brightened significantly. It doesn't stray too far outside of the visible light spectrum, so if there is something blocking those visible light rays from reaching it, the Hubble cannot see through that object. The Pillars of Creation, as beautiful as they are, also presented scientists with a problem. They couldn't see what was on the other side. But fortunately, light behaves differently at different wavelengths. Infrared light has a long wavelength, so it can pass through things that would normally interfere and scatter visible light. Same thing applies to radio waves, which are also on the electromagnetic spectrum, but even lower. A radio mast can sit somewhere on the other side of a hill several miles away from you, but yet your radio can still pick up the signal just fine. Your phone can still get signal even when you're inside of a building, while the cell tower providing that signal is nowhere in sight. And so the JWST launched with the ability to see the infrared spectrum, unlocking the option to see through gas clouds and pick up light coming from much further away. Overnight, humanity now had access to so much more of space than we ever had before, and we found this place, a dwarf galaxy called Pearl SDG. Dwarf galaxies pop up all the time. Astronomers have quite a lot of them on record. Essentially, a dwarf galaxy is one that just contains much fewer stars than a regular full-sized galaxy. It can be anything from 100 billion all the way down to just 1,000 stars. They're usually found close to regular galaxies, orbiting them far enough away to be a separate body, but close enough to circle them slowly. The Milky Way has 20 dwarf galaxies of various sizes in its orbit. Astronomers believe that their formations are usually tied in with regular galaxies they neighbor. Perhaps they wouldn't have formed without having access to the gases slowly drawn to the larger galaxy. Or they may have formed at the same time and been flung apart from one another. They're usually not that interesting, but this one, Pearl SDG, is, because it shouldn't exist. It was discovered almost by accident. Researchers at Arizona State University just happened to study this point in space while conducting other research. They weren't expecting to see anything there. It was believed to be an empty point in space, and yet there was an entire galaxy sitting there waiting to be found. And that was when they noticed what was so strange about Pearl SDG, something we pointed out earlier. There is no gas here, or in other words, there are no new stars forming. Newly formed stars give off a very specific kind of electromagnetic radiation. You can look at a galaxy and right away see if there are new stars forming in it. Pearl SDG has nothing. There are certain rules that apply in the cosmos, rules that can be observed happening repeatedly everywhere we look. One of those is that galaxies form stars. There is gas and dust in pretty much every galaxy in the universe. All of those stars and planets and black holes have a whole lot of gravitational pull. They all come from clouds floating in space, gradually clumping together from the force of their own gravitational attraction. That amount of gas doesn't just get used up in one go. It's an ongoing, continuous process for billions upon billions of years. Look at our Milky Way. It's been alive almost as long as the universe itself, and yet there are stars still forming constantly. Estimates put it at between 4 and 7 new stars per year in the Milky Way. A galaxy that stops forming new stars is what's called a quiescent galaxy. That's when there's no longer enough gas to keep forming stars. There are usually only two ways that this gas gets removed. One, if there's a supermassive black hole in the center that's so powerful that it hoovers all the remaining gas into itself, starving the rest of the galaxy of the clouds it needs to form new life. The other possibility is that the galaxy comes too close to another larger galaxy. The gravitational pull from that interaction could be enough to drag away the gases, leaving the smaller galaxy empty. But look around here again. Look at the galaxy's core. Do Do you see a supermassive black hole at the center of Pearl SDG? Not one strong enough to hoover up all the gas. This is only a dwarf galaxy. There's nowhere near the kind of internal gravitational forces to take it all. And now look out, away from the galaxy to its neighbors. Is there anything close by, another large galaxy that could have stolen its gas? No, there's no evidence of any kind of interaction with another larger galaxy. Pearl SDG is one of the furthest galaxies away humanity has ever looked at. The closest galaxy to the Milky Way is Andromeda at 2.5 million light-years away. As we fly past Pearl SDG, we are 98 million light-years from Earth. And it's all alone. So where did all the gas go? This question has left astronomers and physicists with some quite fundamental questions. We have been confident for a long time now that we understand exactly how stars form and how galaxies work. But what if we don't? What if there's more to it than we know? What if there are forces out there, systems that are much larger and further away than we've ever been able to see, that pull the cosmic strings on a level beyond our capacity to see? With that in mind, it's time for us to enter the wormhole one last time and take a trip to possibly one of the most confusing impossible galaxies. Ready? All aboard! Welcome to Sears 2112. Looks familiar. That's because it's what's known as a barrel spiral galaxy, the same type as our own Milky Way. It's characterized by this beautiful swirling disk full of bright stars and clouds of gases. And as much as Pearl SDG confused astronomers with its existence, this is one of the dozens that have outright challenged our model of the universe. To understand why, we need to quickly dive back into the wavelengths of light. Remember how visible light sits between infrared at the lower end with the longer wavelengths and ultraviolet at the top end with the shorter wavelengths? This is where that very simple knowledge can be used to unlock the biggest secret of them all, the origins of the universe. When the Big Bang happened, it threw everything in all directions. It was a concentrated blast at a single point from which everything was flung away. Even though this happened around 14 billion years ago, everything is still moving outwards, giving us a tiny glimpse into just how powerful the Big Bang was. This means that the universe is expanding. That means that galaxies like Sears 2112, where we're standing right now, are moving away from everything else. In the same way that our Milky Way is moving away from everything, it's all getting further apart as it spreads out, like ripples from a stone thrown in a lake. How can we tell? Well, we look at the wavelengths. Let's say there's a perfectly white star hanging out in space. You stare up at it from Earth, and you can see that it's perfectly white. There are perfectly uniform and smooth waves of light washing toward you. Now, if that star were to start moving toward you, those waves would be squeezed together. The wavelengths would get shorter. That light would start to shift toward the UV spectrum. This is called blue shift. And if we see an object emitting blue shift light, it means it's coming closer to us. But when we look out at distant galaxies and stars through our telescopes, we see something quite uniform. They're all red shifted. Rather than coming closer to us and squeezing the wavelengths, they're getting further away and stretching them, causing them to shift to be red. For years, astronomers have been looking through the Hubble telescope and calculating those levels of redshift of different galaxies, and they can use that data to figure out how fast those galaxies are traveling away from us, and by extension, how old those galaxies are and when the Big Bang took place. Have you joined the dots yet on where the problem with this method comes in? They were using the Hubble telescope, and like we explained before, Hubble could not see far into the infrared spectrum. Galaxies with a stronger redshift were thought to be older, but there were few of them to be seen, so astronomers concluded that most galaxies aren't that old and only formed several billion years after the Big Bang. But when the James Webb Space Telescope went up and people started to take infrared readings of the universe, galaxy after galaxy was showing heavy amounts of redshift, way beyond what they'd previously assumed was possible. All of these galaxies all around us, including Sears 2112, were thought to be younger than our Milky Way and are now looking like they could have been as old as the universe itself. This completely changes how we have to understand the formation of galaxies. All of the comfortable rules we had in place for understanding the universe around us were being shaken up and challenged the more of it we actually saw. Who knows? Perhaps the universe itself isn't the age we think it is. Now check out, you won't believe these insane planets that actually exist. Or watch this video instead.